Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I want to show you how we can use Power Automate to disable a Microsoft form. So this is going to be using an API that's unpublished, albeit I have done a video on this about 12 months ago, showing you how we can access all those form responses, but also how we can delete them too. So this same API will allow us to enable or disable a form using Power Automate. And as well as showing you how to do that, I'll also demonstrate a use case where you might want to disable a Microsoft form based on the number of people that have either completed the form or maybe signed up to an event. So if we take a look at an example Microsoft form we've got here, you can see we have a tick box and manually I can disable the form by unticking that box. Now as an end user, if I was to access that form and we do a refresh, you can see that that form is closed. Equally, if I was to tick that box and then return to that site as the end user, if I do a refresh, you can see that that form is now accessible again. So jumping onto Power Automate, I have a single action based on the send an HTTP request to SharePoint, and then we're using the site address forms.office.com. Method is patch, and you can see we have this long URI, which I have covered in a previous video. But for right now, I'm going to leave as is. Maybe later on in the video, I can show you how we can get these values dynamically. The main thing I really want to concentrate is this body. So we have an object which contains some settings, and we have three different parameters. We have is anonymous, is the form closed, and the form closed message. Now, is anonymous is all based on this setting that we see here on the form, who can fill in the form, either anyone or only people in the organization. And whilst testing, I was just disabling the form. When I enabled the form, I discovered that if I haven't set is anonymous to true, but I had that set on the form here, it would lose that setting and default back to only people in my organization. So a little bonus tip there, if anyone is looking to enable a form and they want that form to be anonymous, you might want to have this is anonymous setting set to true. For the forms closed, at the moment there's no value, but I'm going to set that to true here. And then you can see I have a forms close message saying we've reached capacity, and then I've used a dynamic value for the date and time. So if I was to go and test that, and what I would expect is when I return back to that form earlier and refresh it, it should be disabled. So we'll run that flow, and if I jump across onto the Microsoft form here and refresh, we can see the message we've reached capacity and the date and time. If I go back into that flow, and we will now set this true value to false, and again hit the test button, we would expect that form to become available again, and I should be able to access it as an end user. So we'll just do that and do a quick refresh, and we can see the form is now available again, just like that. So if we now jump into Power Automate, we can see that we have an example from one of my previous videos, which is based on the user signing up for an event and then being sent an invitation based on the number of attendees in an event. But what I'm going to do here is concentrate primarily on how we can use that action we just saw to disable the form based on the number of attendees. So if I look at the Microsoft form, I can see that at the moment I have three responses. And if I jump onto my flow, what we're going to do is we're going to implement some conditions based on the number of responses. So the first thing that I need to do is send another HTTP request to get the row count from the Microsoft form. So what we're using here is the get method, and that will retrieve the number of rows, in this case 3, based on the following expression. So the action above will get all the details of the particular form using the API, and then we can use this expression here, which will retrieve the specific value, which is called row count. And of course, we can then use that row count in a condition. So in that condition, at the moment, I'm going to limit the number of people to 5. So if that row count is less than or equal to 5, I will go down the left-hand side and I will add them to the event. Of course, if it's greater than 5, so 6, 7, 8, I'll send them an email to say, sorry, we have reached capacity. Now, in addition to that, I have another condition. And that condition is slightly different, albeit it's using the same idea. We're using that row count is it greater than or equal to 5? And if it is, we're going to send that HTTP response here or request to update the form close status to true. Now there is a slight difference in the expression. The first one, of course, is it less than or equal to? So all the way up to the number of 5 responses, we will add them to the event. The 6th will then get an email to say that we've reached capacity. In this scenario here, is it greater than or equal to 5? So as soon as it hits 5, rather than as soon as it's greater than 5, we will send this response. And what will happen here is the first, second, third, and fourth user will get an invite. The 5th user will get an invite. But when we hit that 5th user, we'll play out this condition here. It'll of course be greater than or equal to, and we will also disable the form on the 5th user, which means that by the 6th user, they will then access that form and it will come up with a message to say we've reached capacity, or at least that's the hope. The other thing that I have done on my particular solution is using the settings on the ellipsis here is to turn on concurrency control. And that just means that our flows will run in sequential order, starting with the first person that's submitted. So if we have a whole host of people submitting the form at the same time, we won't have loads of flows triggering. They will all sit in a queue and run in sequential order. And that should hopefully reduce the likelihood of someone managing to sneak in there and sign up for an event. So let's go ahead and test this and just see it play out. And what I'm going to do is I'm first of all going to invite myself to the event via the Microsoft form, and of course we'll see the logic play out and I will be able to continue accessing that form. And I have an email address here for Henrietta. I'll jump onto that form. We'll invite Henrietta to the event. We've got the response. I come along as the next person and everything's looking hunky-dory. Again, I come along as the 5th person and I submit. Again, everything's looking good. Now, if I do a refresh, we can see we've reached capacity because we've now hit that 5th. And if I jump across onto the event, we can see I now have my 5th response, and as well as my flow running for the 4th occasion, which was when we did the row count check for Henrietta. We can see we've got the 4th. We branched true, filled out all the information here. We branched false here, so at this point we hadn't disabled the form because we're on the 4th user. If I go and look at the history for our 5th user, which was myself, we will be able to see that the row count will be 5, and the only difference then will be, of course, based on it being 5, same logic here will apply. I'll have been invited to the event, but when it comes to disabling of the form, that expression is true, and then of course we run this action here to disable the form. So there's an example of how to potentially use this API action in order to disable a form based on the number of users that have signed up to an event. This was based on the number of responses within the Microsoft form, but of course, if you were doing it based on the number of attendees for an event, rather than using this particular action here to get the row count, you could count the number of attendees in an array. And if you've been paying eagle-eyed attention, you may have noticed in my condition here that I had an example of an expression that was using the length of the number of attendees in that array. So rather than using the row count for the form, you could use the length of an array based on the number of attendees, or indeed if you're using Excel table, you could be using the length on the number of rows returned there, or a Microsoft list. So lots of different scenarios for your logic, but the same principle applies. So the final piece of my demonstration now is just to show you how to get some of these values dynamically for this particular action. I said that I would show you how to get the tenant ID, the user ID or group ID of where the form has been built, and then finally the form ID. So currently I provided all those values manually. Let's see if we can get them dynamically from Power Automate. So the first action I'd like to use is one that returns the environments I have access to. So we can see list my environments. So I'll go ahead and select that one. Nothing to set up on that particular action. The next one is user profile. So my particular form is installed under my profile. I can use this action, get my profile. And again, I'll be able to get in the GUID for my profile. If, however, I've installed my form under a group, then I can use list teams. And that would enable me to filter the teams, but we'll go ahead and add that in. I'm going to save and test, and then we're going to have to build out some expressions in order to get the tenant ID and the user ID or group ID. So we'll just go ahead and run that, and then we can explore these actions. So list my environments gives me a list or an array of all of my environments. And I know from looking at this earlier that I have an isDefault parameter currently set to false for anything but the default environment. But if we look at the link that we have here, we can see I have my default environment name, which includes a GUID that I'm referencing here that just so happens to be my tenant ID. So if I get my default tenant name, I can then get the GUID for my tenant. The next one is get my profile, and we can see quite easily that we have returned the ID of my profile. So it ends in CAC, and if I was to look at my send an HTTP request, and if I whiz along a bit, we can see, there we go, there is my user ID. So that was quite easy to grab. List teams, we would use that to filter based on the display name to get our group. And again, we could get the ID, but equally, we could also use it to get the tenant ID. So we can see there 0F7, 0F7 up the top there. So two places potentially where we can get the tenant ID from. So I'm going to go and build some expressions now to retrieve the data from these various actions. The first one I want to do is based on list my environments. I'm going to use a filter array action. That filter array is going to filter the values, and we're going to check for the isDefault environment equal to true. And if it is, that will then get me my default environment and I'll be able to get the GUID. I will use a compose, and I just so happen to know that if I was to drop in the environment name, which is the value I'm looking to return from the filter array, it will put me into an apply to each loop. So if I drop that in, there we go, into an apply to each loop, because it expects the data to be in an array. But I can have a quick look here at the output or the input to the apply to each. It's based on the body of the filter, and the environment name is based on the key called name. I need to get the first and only object from the body of the filter, so I can delete this action here, or this expression, sorry. I can also delete this expression. And I want to use first on the body of the filter, and then put question marks and the square bracket, single quotes, and name, which will get me the first and only object from my filter array and return to me the name. If I hit OK, I can actually drag that compose outside of my apply to each now, because it's not dependent, and I can delete. And so that will now return the first and only value from this filter array. But also it has default dash at the front of the name, because we can see again at the top here we have default dash. So I'm going to edit this expression and use the replace expression, and I will simply replace the string default dash with nothing. So you can see at the end there I have two single quotes, and it will replace default dash, and that will just give me the tenant ID. So if I just quickly rename this to tenant ID, I can now in theory go into this expression or this URI here and drop in the value from the composed tenant ID. When it comes to the user ID, we've seen already that I can get that from get my profile. So let's see if we have the ID. There we go. Now, if I want to get this forms ID, which is ending WI4U, I'm not going to be able to get that from this particular trigger because it's based on a manual trigger. But if I go and have a look at the history of one of the previous flow runs, we can see if I look at the output that the form ID is returned here, so WI4U, and it is part of the resource data, and it's in another object with form ID. So if I jump back onto that flow that I'm building right now, so if I now go ahead and delete that manual trigger, I can add in the forms trigger, and we can pick the register for event form, and then we can use the value that comes back from this trigger to populate the HTTP request, just as a proof of concept. So in order to get that particular value, if I go and use a compose here, and we have resource data. So if we have a quick look at the output again, we can see that there is a value there for resource data. And within that, there is an object that contains the form ID and the response ID. We're just looking for the form ID. Therefore, if I choose resource data, we can see the expression there. I'm going to copy this by clicking on it and control C-ing, which lets me jump into the expression tab and paste it in there, delete the brackets and the at, and at the end of this expression, I want to type in form ID in the single quotes and square brackets. So that will now get me the form ID from the trigger that we have here. And again, if I go to my HTTP request, I can update this value here with the value from my output. If I can find it, there we go. So we've now got all those values dynamically based on either listing my environments, the trigger output for the form ID, or get my profile for my user ID. The only difference would be if we had installed that form in a group, we could use list teams, and equally we could do a filter array to look for the team by name, get the ID, potentially get the tenant ID, but very similar process to what I've done for this filter array for list my environments. If I put this into test mode and save and test, what we'll do is we'll just try and trigger this flow and just make sure that it picks up all of those values dynamically and doesn't give us an error message. And with it all being good, we will conclude. So I'll just put in my email address, choose an event, hit submit, go and have a look at this flow, which is now running. We've got a new response being submitted, and we then grab our form ID. We list all our environments, we filter those environments so that we just get the default. We can see the default name, which includes that tenant ID. I then compose the tenant ID, which we've now got there based on getting the first and only name from our filter and then removing that default dash string. I've got get my profile, which of course gets my ID, which is required as well for this particular UI we use. I did use list teams, but of course I'm not going to use that in this scenario, but it was just to demonstrate that you can also get the GUIDs for your teams and also the tenant IDs if you'd rather go that route. And then finally we have our send an HTTP request, and we can see that we have automatically populated the tenant ID, the user ID, which is not going to be selected, there we go, and then finally that forms ID. So there we have it. We have demonstrated how we can disable a form using Power Automate, this particular action that we see here. And we have used that in a solution where we've limited the number of people signing up to an event based on either the number of people that have responded to a form or the number of users that have signed up to an event. Hopefully you found that of use, and look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Thanks very much for watching. Cheers, bye.